Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today. Now I would like to explain about the GIT. I'll try to complete the whole GIT again. Most of the GIT I have done in longer lectures, but now I thought I'll just make smaller videos of 10 to 20 minutes so that it becomes easier for you and for everyone to work through. So now I'm starting the lecture with small intestine, and then I'll go back to stomach, and also after completing the second half of the GIT, then I'll go back to stomach and esophagus and I'll speak about it. But right now I would like to start with small intestine, and in the small intestine I'm starting it with Meckel's diverticulum. In the small intestine, this is Meckel's diverticulum. Meckel's diverticulum is a congenital lesion. Here it is a remnant of an obliterated proximal part of vitelo-intestinal duct. So first, before going into the Meckel's diverticulum, I thought I'll just give you what vitelo-intestinal duct is. So if this is the if this is the umbilicus, there is this is the cecum, this is the ascending colon, and here you'll have the cecum, and here you'll have the appendix, okay, and these are the lobes of the intestine which are there. Now vitelointestinal duct is the vitelointestinal duct. It is a communication between this part of the cecum and the appendix. It is the communication between the sac cecum and the appendix. It is just a tube. If this is the appendix, this is the cecum. This is the, not the cecum exactly, ileum. Okay, this is the ileocecal valve. Around 2 feet from the, this is the ileocecal valve. So around 2 feet from the ileocecal valve, there is a communicating tube which communicates to the umbilicus. So that is called as vitelointestinal duct. Normally, if this vitelointestinal duct obliterates, there won't be any problem. But if this proximal part, that is near the proximal part of the vitelointestinal duct, if that is unobliterated and the distal part is obliterated, and this leads to the formation of Meckel's diverticulum. Here, the proximal part which is there, this is unobliterated. So here this is the cecum, right? This is the appendix, right? This proximal part which is there, that is not obliterated, whereas the distal part near the umbilicus, that is obliterated. So this is vitelointestinal duct. So if you see the vitelointestinal duct, this looks as, so this is the vitelointestinal duct. So these are the loops of the intestine. Now this vitelointestinal duct, it is 2 feet from the distance from ileocecal valve, and it is 2 inches in length. Okay, it is 2 inches in length, and this Meckel's diverticulum, if you see, this Meckel's diverticulum has 3 layers. Okay, it has mucosa, it has serosa, and it also has muscularis mucosa, muscle layer also. It has mucosa, serosa, and also muscle layer. So that is the 3 layers which are seen in Meckel's diverticulum. Now, the mucosa of this Meckel's diverticulum, the mucosa which is there of Meckel's diverticulum, that can be the gastric mucosa, or that can be a colonic mucosa, or that can be pancreatic tissues. So the mucosa which is there, that can be gastric mucosa or colonic mucosa, or it can come from pancreatic tissues. Now, sometimes this vitelointestinal duct, it is obliterated here and it forms a Meckel's diverticulum. That's fine. But the remnant of the second part, the distal part of the vitelointestinal duct, that can form a band. And this band is attached to the Meckel's diverticulum. So because there is a band here, this can cause volvulus formation. Okay, that is one thing which is important. If you see the clinical features, mostly in children it is asymptomatic. At birth it is completely asymptomatic, and in children who are below 2 years of age, in them there can be severe hemorrhage through this Meckel's diverticulum, and that hemorrhage results in maroon colored release of maroon colored stools, and this is because of blood. And hemorrhage, it forms maroon colored stools are seen in the child. And sometimes this this Meckel's diverticulum which is there, that can undergo intussusception. okay, that can undergo intussusception, or that can form bands and adhesions, and sometimes that can even form intestinal obstruction. Intussusception, bands and adhesions, all these can lead to intestinal obstruction. Sometimes this Meckel's diverticulum, it is found incidentally through laparoscopy. Sometimes we do laparoscopy or laparotomy for some other reasons, and at the end it might be found just incidentally. And even sometimes this Meckel's diverticulum, this can herniate out through the anterior abdominal wall. It can herniate out through the wall, and this, whenever there is Meckel's diverticulum in the hernial part, has a hernial content, in such cases it is called as Litter's hernia. If there is appendix in the hernia, then it is called as Little's hernia. Whereas if Meckel's diverticulum is present in the hernial sac, has a content of hernial sac, then it is Litter's hernia. You should remember that. Now, it is also sometimes associated with peptic ulcer or diverticulitis. Now, how are you going to treat, diagnose it first? The diagnosis of this is by technetium 99 radioisotope scan. You can do technetium 99 radioisotope scan. If you do technetium 99 radioisotope scan, this will detect the Meckel's diverticulum. But how? So this technetium 99 scan, this is taken up by the parietal cells. Parietal cells will take this scan, okay, and they will glow. I mean, or they will give some color. They'll go or they'll glow. Okay, these parietal cells are normally present in stomach. Okay, so if this technetium scan is done and if this is positive in stomach, then that is normal, because the parietal cells which take this technetium 99, so they are present in stomach. So obviously if the technetium scan is positive for stomach, then it is normal. But if it is positive for ileum, then there is only one chance that there is Meckel's diverticulum. And in the Meckel's diverticulum, one of the type of epithelium which I have said is gastric epithelium. One type, it is colonic. The third type, it is pancreatic. So this gastric epithelium which is present, this is now taking the technetium scan. So if it is positive in ileum, then you can think that it is due to Meckel's diverticulum. Okay, so this is one of the tests which is done. And you can also do X-ray abdomen for obstruction. Whenever there is obstruction, I said that there can be intussusception, there can be volvulus formation, or there can be adhesions formation, and that can cause intestinal obstruction. In such cases, in order to diagnose the intestinal obstruction, you can do X-ray abdomen. In the X-ray abdomen, you can clearly see multiple air fluid levels, which will help us to diagnose the intestinal obstruction. The confirmation is doing a laparoscopy. In the laparoscopy, you can clearly detect this Meckel's diverticulum. So these are the different tests which are available for Meckel's diverticulum. Now, what about the surgery for Meckel's diverticulum? What is the surgery that you are going to do? So surgery, treatment is through surgery. The surgery depends on whether the Meckel's diverticulum is incidental or simple, or if there is ectopic tissue. Okay, if it's incidental, I have said that in the Meckel's diverticulum, there are two important things. One, this is the thing that this is the Meckel's diverticulum, right? One, presence of ectopic tissue. Okay, if ectopic tissue is positive, think that ectopic tissue is positive, it's not good to leave the ectopic tissue, because this can convert itself into malignancy, or this can cause any types of problems. So ectopic tissue should never be there. If at any chance ectopic tissue is present, maybe simple, maybe incidental, always resect the Meckel's diverticulum. And also, not just diverticulum, here if ectopic tissue is present, never resect only the diverticulum. You will have to resect the entire part. Remember, if this is the diverticulum, never resect the diverticulum. If there is some ectopic tissue, think that the here Meckel's diverticulum is lined by gastric epithelium. Now you will have to remove the whole content. Whole, you should dissect it like this, and then you will have to anastomose it. This is done if there is ectopic tissue. Okay, now again, if it's incidental and it is found in children, then you'll have to do a supportive therapy. Okay, if it is found in adults, then it depends. If it's an ectopic tissue, then you'll have to resect it. If then you'll have to see if there is no ectopic tissue. The ectopic tissue, if you think it is negative, then you'll have to see the mouth of the obstruction, mouth of the Meckel's diverticulum. Think that the mouth is smaller, you know, narrower mouth, or the mouth is wider. Okay, if the mouth is wider, it's not a problem if you leave it. But if the mouth is narrower, this can lead to intestinal obstruction. Okay, so in order to prevent this intestinal obstruction, what we can do is we will have to excise the Meckel's diverticulum. You can do diverticulectomy also in this situation. In this situation, you can just remove this diverticulum also. But it is always feasible and it is good to do the complete resection, because you don't have any doubt that you have left some ectopic tissue which can again pose problem to the patients. This is what we do if it's incidental. If it's a simple Meckel's diverticulum, then you'll have to see whether it is asymptomatic or it is symptomatic. Okay, if it is asymptomatic, you can leave it, provided the neck is wider and there is no ectopic tissue. If there is ectopic tissue, always try to resect it. And if the mouth is narrower, it is better to resect it, because it can cause intestinal obstruction later. And if it is symptomatic, causing diverticulitis, then you'll have to do a diverticulectomy. Okay, depending on whether there is ectopic tissue or not. If ectopic tissue is there, again you'll have to resect it completely. Okay, so this is about Meckel's diverticulum. I think you guys have understood something about Meckel's diverticulum. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.